together. That's Bourne. Relight the asset.
Sir, I need more time.
We have no time.
Are you going to give that order or not?
Sir, please.
You are too naive to see the truth.
There's no bringing in Bourne.
We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick anyone. We enforce them. And at the end of the day, each and every man should go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is September 21st, 2016, and we are coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights Tuesday through Thursday at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern, and you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com and to the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, SoundCloud, Stitcher, and iTunes. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote the we promote self-ownership and the ideas of true freedom and liberty, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and of violence. We are, of course, always happy to hear from you. The phone number is 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664, and you can reach us via Skype and send a contact request to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. It's all one word. And all of that is also at our website, NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com, as well as links to all our Facebook page, Twitter, and other social media. Also, articles and blogs and archives also. So tonight, as we do every other Wednesday, we have Ken Schortgen from The Daily Economist and the relatively new Ken Schortgen channel on YouTube. Ken, thank you, as always, for joining us.
No problem. An evening to you, Dave.
So I had listened to your YouTube show. As I mentioned, Ken's doing a YouTube show at Ken Schortgen. The actual URL will appear on all the archives, so you can click on that. But you can just search for Ken Schortgen or The Daily Economist as well. And there were a couple of things that right away stood out, and I know there's a lot going on, but there's some things that stood out that I want to ask you about. One is something that you didn't mention today, but you may have mentioned it in a previous podcast, because I believe it came out a few days ago. So I don't know if you have any information on this. I'm sure you do, but that it was something like, I don't remember the number, but a certain amount of people that got visas from the Middle East were members of ISIS and they made a big mistake. Is that something you've been following at all?
I've been following it, but I didn't talk about it in my podcast. I try to limit the amount of political stuff, just deal with economics. But, yeah, I mean, the interesting thing is DHS finally came out and admitted, oh, yeah, we We didn't vet about 850 people from terror, sites, locations. Yeah, and nice. We've really not paid attention to them. We've let their visas go, and we found out one's actually working in law enforcement. Another one's working for city officials. So, yeah.
Do you believe that that's – because I would right away, my first thoughts are that that's totally – it's not a fucking mistake. It's on purpose.
Of course it is. I mean – Obama already did an executive order trying to keep from deporting, illegals according to the law. So, and he's already said he wants to bring in 50,000 Syrian refugees a year.
Right. Well, I'm saying that they want to bring in ISIS because they run them, and then they can get them to do more things within the country and use that to take more control. I mean, they had those bombs, if you want to call them that. I mean, no one got killed. From what I understand, there was one serious injury. They called one a black powder bomb, and when I hear that, I automatically think it was fucking gunpowder. I had a friend in high school, believe it or not, who actually made fucking bombs, and he didn't do it to hurt anybody. He did it, like, for fun, and he fucking... This is the how things have changed drastically, and this wasn't that long ago. But freshman year, he lit off a fucking pipe bomb in the school. And it didn't. It was a little one. It didn't do like any damage, except it dented. It put a huge dent in a radiator, and he got expelled. And that was it. If you would have done that today, you'd be like locked up somewhere with an anti-terrorist unit being questioned. I mean, he just got expelled from school. The police didn't even get involved.
Yeah, well, probably what the powers that be would do is they'd actually brainwash you with MKUltra and put you somewhere ready to be called at a moment's notice to do another one, and then they can arrest you and throw you away.
Well, there you go.
Yeah, if you take a look at all the interesting things about this, it looks like the whole thing was a farce because, one... ISIS didn't take, they went out of their way to say, we didn't do this. Secondly, the explosives were pretty cheap. They were put into dumpsters, which wasn't going to cause any damage.
Yeah, I thought of, too. Like, it sheltered people because it was like one of those big dumpsters, right?
Yeah, but here's the thing, okay? The guy was caught. He was sleeping in a doorway.
Right.
And then when the cops came, he just took his gun and he fired a couple times and then just started walking away.
Yeah, the whole thing is very strange. And then they say they were connected, but what do you know about that? Like, because there was some, supposedly there was some in Elizabeth, New Jersey that they found or that went off, but it no one got injured from them. And then there was one in New York, and then there was one that they found that didn't go off at all or something. I don't know. And now they're going nuts, like in Elizabeth, New Jersey, like they want to randomly search anybody with a backpack now, like shit like that. Chris Christie, of course, and his bullshit rhetoric is, talking about, oh, this is like the worst thing since 9/11. And it's just a whole fucking bunch of bullshit.
Yeah, it's always the worst thing when it's in your backyard. But ISIS did claim the knife attacker in Minnesota.
Yeah.
But here's the thing. Here's the real question you have to ask. Why all of a sudden did this happen? Well, what occurred the day before that was about to create an international incident?
Yeah, I heard you mention that on your show, and then I missed what it was.
Yeah, I forgot what the incident was.
Yeah, that's what you had said.
On.
Yeah, that you had forgot.
Well, here's
forgot.
The incident.
What was it?
The United States military bombed
Syria
military base.
Right. Well, I was going to bring that. Yeah, I was going to bring that up and ask you about that as well, but I didn't realize it happened the day before. So, that will get that out of the news pretty quick. And that's a common thing that they do to get things off the front page. I mean, they've been doing that for, you know, decades, where something to get it off the front page, they'll, you know, make sure something else happens that's more serious that will get people talking about that. So, yeah, I was going to, that was the other thing I was going to ask you about, that there was a ceasefire, from what I understand, and correct me if I'm wrong in any of this, but from what I had read, that there was a ceasefire agreed to by Russia and the U.S., and then they come in and fucking bomb the Syrian army.
Yeah, exactly. The United States attacked.
Like after a week,
Syrian military. Well, that being aside, if you're a foreign power and you go into some a foreign territory's airspace and you bomb a military base, isn't that an act of war?
Yeah, but I mean, it's even worse because they just agreed to a ceasefire a week before that, right?
Yeah, but you've been studying the thing. The ceasefire was supposed to include, because the U.S. controls the Free Syrian Army, i.e. al-Nusra, al-Qaeda,
ISIS,
and
all
and the ceasefire was that U.S. was going to tell the Free Syrian Army, you're going to back up, we're going to go into negotiations, et cetera. But the Free Syrian Army, the terrorists, the non-ISIS terrorists, had been breaking the ceasefire all week, okay, with little things. And then what ended up happening was ISIS was on this ridge overlooking the Syrian military base.
Yeah, I heard that they had it surrounded, or something.
The Syrians were about to go attack them, and the U.S. went in and bombed and destroyed the thing and opened up the channel, which ISIS then moved past the base and into Syria. So the U.S. explicitly, they called it a mistake. First, they said they didn't do it. Secondly, they said that Russia did it. It wasn't them. Third,
they finally admitted it at some point.
It was a mistake.
Yeah, everything's a mistake with them. The visas, you know, letting ISIS in, whatever, was a mistake. And fucking the Boston bombing, you know, oh, his name was different on the when he flew to Russia. We didn't know. They've run out of excuses. So now it's just, oh, we made a mistake. And yes, we do know that government it is stupid, but I mean, they're not that stupid. Okay. It's, you know, they're running out of excuses.
Yeah. Well, it's kind of interesting because the excuses are actually flying fast and furious. And I want to bring this point. This is a Harvard professor. Okay. This Harvard professor wrote an op-ed in the New York Times saying that the reason that Hillary is going to lose is because of a biased media. Now, if you've been paying attention to the media, has the media been covering any of Hillary's corruption or her medical problems or any of that? They've been going out of their way to make it a non-story. In fact, they fired a longstanding doctor with CNN who said that Hillary had Parkinson's, late-stage Parkinson's, and then Huffington Post,
yeah, we talked about that yesterday.
And, you know, who had been on there for, you know, he'd written hundreds of articles.
There was the guest I had on yesterday, he had said that the guy who got fired, actually, either he put out a tweet or a blog or something saying that I'm not going to commit suicide. So if anything happens to me,
yeah,
you hear about that as well. Yeah. So which sounds weird. But I mean, in a way it doesn't, but, you know, with the way that journalists have been gone after and some of them even killed.
See, last weekend, the Huffington Post put out what we would call a premature obituary. The article was said, why Hillary lost. We're not even to the debates yet. And Huffington Post is giving up on Hillary. They know that the writing's on the wall. And they put 9 reasons why Hillary was going to lose. Let me read these off to you. The media. The media went after Hillary, and they were biased, and they didn't protect her from all of her scruples. The second reason is that the Russians are in league with Trump. to win to do the election. The third thing that they're blaming are millennials. You know, because the millennials who followed Bernie Sanders for his run, they're not going over to Hillary. So the HuffPo is blaming the millennials. Then, of course, they're blaming Bernie Sanders for why didn't Bernie Sanders get out of the race earlier? Then they're blaming Bill Clinton because they say Bill Clinton has lost his mojo and he's hurting her campaign. HuffPo is then saying that most of American men are sexist.
Yeah, they always want to blame the shit on
that. Then they're blaming the FBI director, James Comey. And this is what they say. He might as well have indicted her for real, like he did in the court of public opinion. Well, she committed treason by mishandling classified information. Well, you know. And then, of course, Debbie Wasserman Schultz and the DNC. The DNC scandal, the email scandal with the DNC was so great, it hurt Hillary's chances. Well, you know what? After the DNC thing, Hillary went up by like 5 or 7 points when Trump was screwing himself, going after, you know, making comments about the Gold Star family and a number of other things. Hillary had this in the bag, and then all of a sudden, she started opening her mouth, and she started getting sick, and then it was over. As a matter of fact, I'm hearing some scuttlebutt from some of my sources that I work with. The Democratic Party has actually given up on Hillary. They are now preparing for Donald Trump to win. And what they're going to do is they're going to do one of two things. They're going to rely upon their control over Congress and the courts to stifle Trump through his entire presidency.
Well, I thought they don't have right now. They don't have control of Congress.
No, not the Democrats. The neocon establishment. The establishment.
Oh, okay.
You know, there is no Democrats and Republicans. There's either ones who are bought and paid for in the cabal,
right?
Or there's not.
Which is most of them. So.
Which is most of them. So they're going to use those to stifle Trump and anything he's trying to get across.
Well, I know you're a Trump supporter. I don't think Trump's going to do anything positive except make a more authoritarian state. So, and
well, that being aside, there, you know, that being aside, there's out of the four
based on stuff that he said, you know, himself.
Out of the four candidates, you know, to me, the most important thing is Second Amendment. Don't touch my guns.
Yeah, well, Trump has said stuff in the past, so I don't know how much you can trust him on that. But yeah, that's very important to me. But I don't give a fuck because I'll tell you straight up that I don't care what laws they pass. If you want to take my guns away from me, you better fucking be ready to fucking start shooting.
Yeah,
that's I don't give a fuck, and I'll say it on the radio. I don't care. That is my right. And, you know, once you give that up, I mean, we're fucked as it is. But, you know, and I've been watching some Larkin Rose stuff, and he has all these quotes from, you know, Mao and Stalin and Hitler and all the stuff that they had said about, you know, guns and stuff like that, and how it was such a priority for them to get the guns. And and I didn't even know this. You know that Washington actually even made a statement that I kind of make now, where he made it in a totally different way, but it really the same principle, where I say that the only way that we can have checks and balances is if the people were as armed as the police or the military. And that he actually made a statement.
Back in the time before the Civil War, they actually, and even a little bit after the Civil War, you could actually, if you were a regular citizen, you could buy a cannon.
Yeah, well, that's what he said, that the citizens should be more better armed than any military or any government, you know, because if something happens. Now, of course, you know, it's not even close. But, you know, this idea that, well, the founding fathers didn't know the type of weapons that were going to come out. Well, it doesn't matter. If they were saying shit like that, that you should have more weapons than the government, what does it matter what the type of weapons are? I mean, obviously, they would still say the same thing, even with the type of weapons that they have now. So this whole fucking bullshit that, oh, they meant, you know, the well-regulated, you know, the argument of progressives that they meant it was about a militia. It wasn't about an individual right.
The progressives will use anything because they're all criminals and mentally insane. Okay. This is the same thing, you know. The whole argument of the Second Amendment is that
even the fucking Civil Liberties Union says the same thing.
Comma, okay, or that semicolon. They think that that's two separate clauses meaning tied to the same thing. No,
it's
two separate clauses meaning two different things.
Right.
But the other side of the coin is take a look at what Bill Clinton got away with. It just matters what the definition of is. I mean, anybody with a fifth grade education could tell that, you know, he was criminally liable.
He was involved in selling cocaine, or at least getting it to people to distribute.
See,
and I'm sure he made money off it as well.
You know, they like to joke that
Became president.
Look, but they like to joke that Donald Trump is the first reality TV president, but Bill Clinton was the first reality TV president. Bill Clinton, when he was running, went on all the shows. He played his saxophone.
Yeah,
he went on MTV and started talking about his underwear. I mean, he was just a reality TV, wino.
The other thing about Clinton that people forget, and I remember this for some reason, is that he made a speech in 1988 at the Democratic National Convention and almost got booed off the stage.
Right.
I don't know if you remember that, but he just droned on and people were like, fucking shut the fuck up already and finish. And then, you know, he came out of nowhere, little corrupt Arkansas governor, and you know, that was a whole fucking member of the Trilateral Commission.
Yeah, but he's not the first no-name governor.
Jimmy Carter.
Yep. And Jimmy
Carter
was
a member of the Trilateral Commission too.
They didn't have a trilateral then.
No, they did. He was a member.
Okay, there's two of them. There's the Council on Foreign Relations, which was from 1921.
Right.
There's the Trilateral Commission that was started by Zbigniew Brzezinski.
And Rockefeller was involved as
so
well.
It was in its infancy.
Yeah, it was.
Brzezinski was the one who picked Jimmy Carter, and, you know, made him sell his soul to the devil and got him into the presidency.
Right, but it must have been, you know, it might have been around for a couple years, but it was, you know, yeah, he was part of that whole thing.
Yeah,
I think
it was created in either 71 or 73.
I'll actually look it up, but I remember that Rockefeller was involved from reading his autobiography. And then the CFR has been around, I think, since 1920.
Yeah, the CFR came into being when Woodrow Wilson could not get Congress to ratify the League of Nations Treaty.
Yeah, so that's around that time.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so I mean, that's what they did. I mean, Jimmy Carter was the same thing. Yeah, July 73, founded by Rockefeller.
Yeah, and Carter won in 74. So yeah. It was in its extreme infancy then.
Yep. So.
By the way, you know what the Trilateral Commission is?
It was supposed to be the North America, Western Europe, and Japan.
That's a surface thing where it came from. Zbigniew Brzezinski, okay, was a professor at either Princeton or Columbia.
Yeah, that's what it says where I'm reading right now. He was a professor at Columbia, and he ended up being the national security advisor to Carter.
Right, but here's the thing. Back in the 1930s,
and he was a Rockefeller advisor at the same time when he was when he was a professor at Columbia University, he was also a Rockefeller advisor. It says who was a specialist on international affairs.
Right. Let me give you some background.
And it says he left the group or left his post to organize the group. So the founding was, you know, Rockefeller, Zbigniew Brzezinski, and it lists maybe like six or seven other names as well. some people from the council, a guy from the Council of Foreign Relations, a guy from Harvard, a governor of Pennsylvania. Sorry, go ahead.
No worries. You got to go back because it extends.
Oh, even Greenspan and Paul Volcker.
Oh yeah, most of our
founding members.
Here's the whole scoop behind that. You got to go back to the 1930s during the Great Depression. The United States was virtually at the point of losing, you know, being overtaken by a dictator or authoritarian. You had a big communist march for all the people who were unemployed. Communism started sinking in.
Yeah, even in Hollywood, I mean, you had where the McCarthy hearings came from was in the 30s. Even people in Hollywood were, you know, becoming members of the Communist Party and whatnot.
Yeah, and there was if you can look up, for anybody who wants to search, you can look up probably one of our greatest generals, Smedley Butler. But a group of elites came to, you know, the Dulles brothers, John Foster Dulles, Alan Dulles, and a whole bunch of others in that time. They came up to Smedley Butler and said that, you know, we will back you if you want to do a coup in an over.
Yeah, we talked about him last night. We talked about more. I mentioned how they came to him about overthrowing the government. But he also, before that, I guess, wrote like some, it's not a book, but like some kind of.
It's a treatise. Like, it's called War is a Racket.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. We had talked about that yesterday.
So anyway, getting back to the 1930s, at Columbia, there was a movement.
Yeah, there's a big difference. Columbia University and Columbia, the country.
Yeah, or Columbia, South Carolina, or Columbia, Missouri. There was a movement, okay? All these elites at Columbia were starting to get together, and they decided that during the Great Depression, the financial system we have, run by elected officials by, you know, of the people, was outdated, didn't work, you know, and so they needed to create a system, and this is what they call the system, government or control of society or industry by an elite of technical experts. The scientists should run the world. And this grew in the 1930s and was known as technocracy, okay? Unelected officials who only experts can run a government and run industry and run society. They know best for you. Anyway,
which became more of just people that have, you know, families with billions of dollars as opposed to experts in the future.
Well, yeah, but this was.
No, but I'm saying in the future, like now, it became more, you know, it evolved, I guess, into that.
But I'll give you some great examples because this is probably important because it is still occurring today in a different form. But you got to know the history behind it to understand how it evolved. Okay, this is at Columbia University. There were at its height in the 1930s, there were 50,000 members of the society, Technocracy Society. But then
that what it was called, the Technocracy Society? Okay,
Technocracy Society. Then World War II came. And pretty much, you know, the government stamped down anything that was anti-American or even, you know, whatever. There were the intern camps for both Germans and Japanese. Most people don't remember that there were intern camps for Germans. But there was for Germans and for the Japanese.
But I think for Germans, though, wasn't it actual people that only people that came over from Germany that weren't American citizens?
Yes, but during the wartime, they sort of, you know, didn't, you know, because they threw regular Japanese Americans who had been more than one generation.
Yeah, like, that's what I'm saying. Japanese Americans, they put Japanese people that were born here in the camps.
Right, exactly.
I don't believe they did that with the Germans, but I...
No, they did that with the Germans in World War One, though. World War One was far, far more than World War Two for the Germans. Anyway, that aside, technocracy sort of died out.
Well, it's fucked up either way you look at it, you know, but that's a whole other story. But
so anyway, the war came, technocracy sort of died out. Then we had the Cold War, so that sort of took everybody's mind. But there was a nice little professor in Columbia who decided to look into the archives. His name was Zbigniew Brzezinski. And in the late 60s, he stumbled upon all the works of the Technocracy Society. And one of the things that the Technocracy Society believed in, because remember I said it came out of the fact of the Great Depression, the stock market crash, and their belief that capitalism was, you know, was not a way to do the monetary system.
Is he the rules for radicals guy, or am I thinking of somebody else?
No, that's Saul Alinsky.
But they're similar type people.
Zygmunt Brzezinski wrote The Great Chessboard. That's his famous book. So anyway, Brzezinski found all this stuff for the Technocracy.
And he was a political scientist, okay.
And right. One of the things that he discovered in the teachings of the Technocracy was rule by experts and elites over society, and that money and capital should be replaced by energy. Energy would be the money, okay? Well, this was in the late 60s.
How would you – that just sounds asinine.
Hold on a second. We saw that the Trilateral Commission was created in 1973. What else was created in 1973? By Henry Kissinger, also a Trilateral and CFR member. The petrodollar, money backed by energy.
It was around that time.
Yep. So they were able to turn that in.
So they basically, they did do it because oil is the true money
in the world. Okay. So anyway, Zygmunt Brzezinski, and they got the trilateral and they did all this. Well, what is the next stage of money? Money tied to energy. Well, what have they been doing for the last 5 years? Carbon credits. Your carbon footprint, your energy footprint. You're going to get your credits, or you're going to pay your debits based on your carbon footprint. So this technocracy, you know, technocracy actually also carried over after the 2008 credit crisis in Europe. If you remember, Spain, Italy, Greece, all after the financial crisis, they all lost their leaders, and the European Central Bank put in three technocrats, three Goldman Sachs bankers. Rajoy was in charge of Spain, Papandreou was in charge of Greece, and Mario Monti was put in charge of Italy. They were unelected, they were Goldman Sachs bankers, but they became the prime ministers and presidents of the country. See, the technocracy movement is still around in different forms,
right?
But the attempt is to get rid of money, to get rid of capital, to have all the means of production controlled by the elites, the experts. You know, and if you think about it, we've created a society.
Well, they're not really the experts, but they're in control of they have enough money and power to control things.
Don't get the money out of your mind, okay? Think about this. In our society, if you have a PhD or a doctor in front of your name, do people almost automatically believe what you have to say?
Yeah, I mean, that's true.
They've
as well.
These are the experts.
Well, because they were, you know, a lot of the elites come from, like, if you take the Rockefellers, generations, and they all went to the best schools, and it doesn't mean they knew anything.
But you're missing the point. Those guys are above the technocracy. The technocracy are just a bunch of schleps who follow, who are like sociopaths, who follow the belief that they are more intelligent and are better suited to lead than it's not a matter of money.
No, these guys, I know what you're saying. You know,
But it's the money behind them that is funding this. Just like George Soros put so much money into funding all these movements and all these
like Black Lives Matter, and it's a communist front, and in any of those movements, they occupy Wall Street or whatever. Even if they start out as, you know, grassroots movements, they all end up, you know.
You remember
the Tea Party as well. I mean, it's. It's
you remember
been
Rothschild's
corrupted.
famous quote: give me the power to print the nation's money, and I care not who makes its laws. Rothschild, except for the single Rothschild family who gets passed down generationally to sit in the House of Lords in Britain.
They were,
and none of the, you know, Rockefellers are not in the same league as Rothschild.
The Rothschilds were the ones who would get people to go to war and fund both sides of it and make money and be able to get control out of it.
Yeah, what they did was
they did that with I think the first one with Napoleon, and reading about that.
Yeah, but they didn't get them to go to war. What he did was he used that war for his first big payday, and then from then what ended up happening was Max Bauer or somebody Bauer,
Jack Bauer.
he came to Prussia from Caesarea, place what is now Georgia on the Black Sea.
Right.
And he was a goldsmith, but he ended up lending some money to the to a prince over the Prussian Empire. And what he discovered is that you can make so much more money lending to governments than you can lending to the people.
Well, you also get the power out of it as well.
Right. So what he did was he got this prince into deep debt and then used that to be able to say, you know what, I'll absolve your debts.
Right.
I'll even give you some gold if you let me control the monetary system.
Exactly. Well, that's why the whole thing with – the other benefit of lending to governments, you know, lending to businesses and your average person.
You know why you lend to governments and nobody else? Because governments can tax and you're assured of being paid back. So anyway,
we're all collateral on the debt, but not just that, not just the payback, but the control that you have over the government when they're indebted to you.
Right. But here's the thing. You know, this is a bunch of bankers. They may hire a few mercenaries to protect them, but they can't stop an army. So what keeps a government, a king, from just telling the banker, you know, screw you, I'm not paying you back, and I'm going to kill you? What keeps them from doing that?
Not going to get any more money.
What? No, it doesn't matter. They'll just confiscate all the money. They'll steal it. They'll just say, trump up a charge, take all the money you got in your bank, all the gold you got in your bank, and put it in the coffers. What they did was they did something that's ingenious. They took their original bank in Prussia, and the original Rothschild, he changed his name to Rothschild. He had five sons. So he sent the five sons to five different countries. Britain, France, Germany wasn't a country yet, Italy, you know, and a couple others, Switzerland, I believe.
Spain.
And what he did was he set up banks there, and he got the governments, the kings indebted to him and control over the monetary supply.
That's
what he did was if one country was going to default on their debts, then that banker in the other country, say like France was going to default on its debt, then the brother who was in charge of the bank in Britain
and the other
would go to the king and say, hey, you know what? We're gonna have to cut you off from lending money unless you go and attack France.
Right, right.
And so, it's called the balance of power.
Right.
I understand what you mean. Each one against each other.
But that was still like being that it was a state, they were able to control those states. And Rockefeller did something similar when he was like running a bank because he was in charge of the like foreign. He went to South America and tried to get them totally indebted to the bank, but I think really the U.S. I mean, his story, man, is fucked up. He was over in Germany in the 30s as well.
Oh, yeah.
And
Rockefellers.
Well, this is David Rockefeller that I'm talking about, but I mean, all of them. But I mean, he even says, really, in his autobiography, he kind of admits all of this shit. I mean, he's arrogant about it because he addresses the question of, you know, trying to control governments and things like that and being involved in
Sure. And, you know,
secret societies. And
David Rockefeller in the 1970s.
And he's still alive, and he's like in his 90s. I mean, how the fuck can this guy still be alive?
No, he's 103, and he just had his seventh heart transplant.
Are you sure he's 103? Because last time I checked, he was like 94.
No, he's well over 100.
So are you saying that that's the age he gives is a lie?
Well, no. You can take a look.
No, he's not. He's in his because
born June 12th, 1915, age 101.
Oh, okay, then you're right. Yeah. Probably what fucked me up is he wrote his book in like 2002. So okay, you're right.
Or somebody wrote it for him. Yeah, but no, Rockefeller has just he had his sixth heart transplant 2 years ago, and it started failing him, so he got a seventh. What he's trying to do is he's trying to remain alive enough
until that you can merge with machines.
And yeah, until you can upload your brain or your mind to a machine. That's what he's trying to do.
Yeah, it's crazy.
But David Rockefeller was in the 1970s, we're talking Soviet Union, anti-capitalist. There was one private bank in Moscow. It was Chase Manhattan.
Yep, which is he was the chief executive of Chase Manhattan.
Yeah, exactly. And when the Soviet Union fell, David Rockefeller was actually the authority who was taking care of the bankruptcy and the breakup of the Soviet Union. He was still in Russia until about 5 years ago, 5-6 years ago, when somebody knocked on his door and told him, you're either going to leave now or we're going to kill you. And that was Vladimir Putin.
I'm surprised that he can even fucking think. I mean, there's probably a lot of technology that just the elite have access to. Well, I'm talking medical technology, and it might be because of the cost as well. But, you know, he must be getting the best possible health care you can get, and whatever, you know, medical technology exists, he's getting it, because it sounds like his brain's still there. And I mean, how many people at 101, you know, still are all there, you know? I mean, I don't know that he is, but I'm just saying, I mean, he's still involved in all of this shit. So he has to be to a certain extent, you would think, right?
Who knows? Who knows? You know, one day, in my opinion, everybody's going to have to stand before their maker. And if you want to have your treasures on Earth and screw everybody, well, you know what? Eternity's a little bit longer than your 100 years of life.
According to what's his name, who he ran for governor of Nevada. Actually, he was a producer of Trading Places, and he did a Freedom to Fascism. He did the movie Freedom to Fascism. Did you see that, the documentary?
I've heard of it, but I haven't seen it. No.
Anyway, he said that he became friendly with one of the Rockefellers because he was a Hollywood guy. I can't think of his name right now. I can picture his face. But he ran for governor in Nevada as a libertarian, and he was going to run again, but he ended up dying of cancer. But he had said that basically they would say, you know, they'd look at people like they weren't even humans. You know, everybody else to them was nothing. Like, you know, all these billionaires and whatever were all the important, smart. Like you said, I mean, they all think they're geniuses and whatever, and that they should be running everything, and that everybody else to them is just animals, essentially. Cattle.
Oh, sure. But these guys are sociopaths or psychopaths. You know, I could tell we could have a show maybe one time on the book I wrote, Israel Deception, because there is a legitimate reason why people always say that the Jewish
Aaron,
bankers.
Sorry, not to interrupt, but Aaron Russo was his name.
Yeah.
But go ahead.
There's a reason why you can say, you know, everybody likes to make the thing, well, you know, all the bankers are Jews and the Jews are doing this. they're half right.
Well, where's my money? Because, you know, the Jewish side of my family was the poor side. They drove cabs and were in the cab industry. My great-grandfather supposedly stabbed somebody. I think he killed him because he didn't pay him a fare. So he saw him in the bathroom. I think he was, like, out of urinal, and he, like, stabbed him in the back, literally. And, yeah, they were all – my father, my grandfather, my great-grandfather on my father's side were all, you know, cab drivers or cab dispatchers or in the cab business. My grandfather, I don't think, even graduated high school. He joined the Army at 14 for World War II. He lied. I guess he looked – he had, like, a full beard – and he lied and said he was 18. And back then, you know, it's not like it is now where everything's totally tracked. And he went to the Army at like 14.
Yeah, you know, I saw there was a story about a kid. He was 12 years old. And he looked barely old enough. And he got into the military. He did some heroic things, got, besides Purple Hearts, got a Silver Star. And then they discovered that he was... even though he had been a hero, they discovered he was underage, and they threw him in prison for 2 years.
That's fucked up, man. All his medals,
and then finally, you know, like 3 decades later, they finally gave it back to him. You know, it's sad. Bureaucracy is sad.
That's just ridiculous. But yeah, he had joined the military and was in World War II, and I guess he had always lied. I guess to my father and said he graduated high school, but he never even graduated high school. And my parents didn't go to college neither. So my point being that that's the Jewish side of the family, and they didn't have shit.
See,
so
there are two different types of Jews, okay? There are blood Jews, and there are converted Jews.
Yeah, no, they were blood Jews.
The Rothschilds are converted Jews, and they're not converted Jews of Torah. They're converted Jews of the Talmudic rewriting of Judaism that took place in the first to third centuries, when after Titus destroyed Jerusalem in 70 AD and kicked everybody out, the exile. Well, the Pharisees, the ones Jesus called the spawn of Satan, they went to Babylon and they rewrote all of Judaism with creating the Torah, the Mishnah, the Kabbalah, the Gemara, the commentaries, etc. And they went and they started converting a number of individuals to this new Talmudic. And the reason I know that it's true is because if you look in the Jewish encyclopedia, both 1905 and 1943, mm-hmm. It says right there that Talmudic Judaism was created in about 300 BC or 300 AD in Babylon, and is practiced as Judaism the worldwide today.
So what is how do you know if you're a blood Jew, first of all, and you have the Black Israelites that claim they're the original Jews, and that
that's where it's kind of hanky. Because
let me just say something real quick, though. Like, you know how there's certain features, like somebody looks kind of Jewish? Like, my father had, like, Brillo, like, his hair was like Brillo.
Right.
And, you know, he looked either like Hispanic or Italian or, you know, Jewish. Like, he was like that kind of. But my great grandparents, his mother's parents, and my grandmother during the summer got dark, too. Her parents came from Russia right before they became communists, and she had said by way of Spain at some point, but I don't know.
Well, sure. And I'll tell you a little secret about the Iberian Peninsula. Okay. Anyway, what ended up happening was after 300 AD, the Pharisees and the Jews that had exiled to Babylon started moving outward. Okay. Some went north, west, and they ended up going onto the Iberian Peninsula. Iberian Peninsula being Portugal, Spain, and France. The others went east to the Black Sea, and they moved into places like Ukraine, Khazaria, and then the steppes of Russia. Now,
Well, that would make sense in both instances, whether they Spain or Russia.
Exactly.
Because she did mention Spain before, because I asked her, like, during the summer, man, she would get fucking dark, like really dark. And I'm like, how do you, you know, and my father, too. And she mentioned that something about Spain. So I don't know if her parents' parents or at what point, but they came over from Russia, like right during the, you know, in like 1913 or something.
Right.
My great grandparents on, my father's mother's parents.
Okay. Now here's what happened. I've got documentation from a rabbi in about the 9th century, who went to Caesarea, and he converted the entire aristocracy, including the king of Caesarea, to Judaism. And the king then declared that Judaism, now this, like I said, this is Talmudic Judaism, not the original Torah, right, Judaism. He converted them. They weren't blood Jews. These were Slavics who were in this area. Converted all of Caesarea, and the king declared that the entire country and all the population are now Jews. Okay? Well, about 700 years after that, that's when the Bauer, a.k.a. Rothschild family, left Caesarea and went to Europe into Prussia. So that's why you could say that almost all the bankers are Jews, but they're not blood Jews. They're converted Jews following Talmudic Judaism.
What about
the difference between Torah and Talmudic Judaism? Okay, and this is the important thing. The Torah, you cannot charge usury, interest, for lending money. Talmudic Judaism, you can't charge interest to other Jews to lend money, but you can charge interest to the goyim, everybody else.
The goya.
Yeah. Exactly. And that's why they became bankers, is because they prostituted the original Judaism and started charging interest.
Well, my family weren't bankers, so I don't know. But I didn't follow the religion. And my father almost became a rabbi, he had told me. But by the time he was an adult, he wasn't religious neither. I don't think he believed in religion.
There was a diary that was found from around late 1400s, early 1500s. And the diary was of a sailor who left Spain just ahead of the Spanish Inquisition. And he was Jewish. You know what his name was?
No.
Christopher Columbus.
Oh.
His real name was Christopher Colon.
I thought he was Italian.
Well, not really. His family may have been from there, but he grew up in Spain, but he was Jewish.
I'm sure you'd piss off a lot of Italians, right?
Well, here's an interesting thing.
He wasn't fucking Jewish.
Christopher Columbus really never discovered
the United States. The Bahamas or something.
Right. But he discovered Nevis Island. And if you go to Nevis Island or do some research of it today, there is a 550-year-old synagogue on Nevis Island.
That was built by Columbus?
Columbus and his people. Here's the interesting thing about the difference between this is Spanish. I mean, from Spain, not Hispanic from Mexico.
Right, right. That. No, I know.
From what I've been told, if your last name ends with a Z, then you are Spanish. If your last name ends with an S, you are Jewish.
Well, so what if it doesn't end with neither?
Hernandez. Well, I
are you talking about saying, Spanish?
I'm just saying that you know how Spanish Spaniards will end the name with a Z instead of an S.
Right. Right.
Yeah. Those are. It's either the other. It's either that those that end Z are Jewish, or those who end in the S are Jewish.
So, real quick,
you know, that's how you can tell the difference.
But you know how there's supposedly different races of Jews, like Sephardic Jews and the Ags.
Right.
How do you pronounce the Ashkenazi. Yeah, and they're supposed to be. There's studies that they're supposed to have the highest IQs.
Sephardics were the Jews that left Babylon and went up the Iberian Peninsula and into Spain, France, and Portugal. The Ashkenazi are the ones who went to the Black Sea and up through Ukraine, Georgia, Russia, and then into Eastern Europe.
Yeah, and they're supposed to have the highest IQs. I know on my father's father, it's something like I'm like eighth or ninth generation, and supposedly they were from Germany. Somebody came over from Germany or something, but I don't know a lot about. I mean, that was in the 1800s at some point. So, and that's just my father's side, but that's the Jewish side. On my mother's side, she was Catholic. So, but supposedly, well, based on Stefan Molyneux did this whole thing, and I've heard it from other people as well, that supposedly they have the highest IQs of anybody collectively. But yeah, who knows?
So some of the it's easy. If your name ends in EZ, then you are Jewish. Vasquez, because the EZ represents son of. Vasquez was son of Vasco, Gonzalez, son of Gonzalo, Marquez, son of Marcos, Fernandez, son of Fernando. That was the Sephardic. If you were Sephardic, if your last name ended in EZ, because the EZ from Spain represented son of.
Right. Yeah, I don't know what my great-grandmother's maiden name was, so I don't know about her. But,
probably Cohen.
No, but my great grandfather was Gropman. Which is a Jewish name.
Goldschmidt or Goldsmith or.
And Bourne is a German.
Bourne is German.
So that's where that came from. But it could have been like Bornstein or something, and they dropped the. Who knows?
Bourne is a legitimate name.
There's a lot of Bournes. There is really a Bourne legacy.
Yeah, there you go.
There's an actual Bourne, but it has nothing to do with the CIA. So
my ancestry, Schortgen, comes from Belgium. But here's the fascinating thing. That area, I forget what it's called. Luxembourg, Belgium, and another country, Switzerland maybe. There's a reference to those states. Anyway, in Luxembourg, what is now Luxembourg? It wasn't back then. What is now Luxembourg? There are two types of Schortgens. There's mine, which is S-C-H-O-R-T-G-E-N. But there was also S-H-O-R-T-G-E-N. If it has S-C-H, it's Germanic. If it has S-H, it was French.
Well, that's like with Irish and Scottish, too, because my mother's...
Mick and Mac.
My mother, yeah, exactly. My mother's, on my mother's side, my grandfather was Scottish, and it was Mac. I'm not going to say the whole name because I don't want to say my mother's maiden name, but yeah, it was Mac. And then the Irish were Mick. And I think that's where, obviously, Mick came from. That's supposed to be a derogatory term, but yeah. That was the difference between the Irish and the Scottish.
Well, exactly.
Among other things, but I mean, name wise. So we're approaching the end of the first hour. So let's take a break and play some valuable clips. And when we come back, I know there's a lot of other things going on to talk about. With the Chinese, the Japanese, and their meeting today. And, of course, gold's always in the news. So, and of course, some other stuff as well. So we're going to take a break and play a few clips. And when we come back, we got much more to talk about with Ken Schortgen of The Daily Economist, dailyeconomist.com. And you can go to his YouTube channel, Ken Schortgen, but you can actually get the link because the links on YouTube, you can actually change it and name your link once you have it for a certain amount of time or something. I don't know. You should probably can do it now. So it's like, it would be like /Ken or something, you know, so you could actually give out the URL. But now it's like a bunch of letters or whatever. But I still put that in the description. So essentially, Spreaker posts to all the sites that the archives go to. So it will be on all those sites, the link. But not like it's not easy to find if you search for it in YouTube anyway. So Ken comes out with important information. What is it, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, or something like that every other day?
Yeah, I try to do Monday, Wednesday, Friday, but I tell everybody that I'm going to do 2 to 3 a week. So if I just don't feel like doing one on a certain day, I'm just not going to do it. You know, the reason I started behind it is a lot of people wanted me to do a podcast of some sort.
Well, I told you should do one too.
Yeah. I mean, several people did, including you, but I just didn't want it to become a burden. So,
right. You don't want it to.
I'm going to take a day off. Right. You got to live with it.
Yeah, and that's, you know, gives you that flexibility. And that's what a lot of people do with YouTube videos anyway. Or, I mean, yours is more an audio with, you know, pictures. But a lot of people do that. You know, they have, you know, when they post a video, they post a video. Even Malin, who does that shit, he just posts videos when he feels like posting videos. So.
You get a big enough following, and you don't need to do, you know, that many. If you got 100,000 people, and you're going to get 250,000-300,000 views for every video you do, you're going to get some pretty good ad revenue. So you don't have to do that many.
Yeah, you know, just an aside. I mean, it's crazy that you have these people. A lot of them in their 20s, and it makes me feel old because they're saying shit that I have no idea what the fuck they're talking about. Some of the words they use, you know, they talk about social justice warriors and they're talking about different, you know, there's thousands of genders and whatever. But they're getting like 300,000 views for like a 5 or 10 minute video. And I'm like, just out of nowhere. I don't know how the fuck, and I mean, it's fine and everything, but I mean, it's nothing great. I just, you know, at work, I need shit to listen to. So,
but we're a reality TV, 5 minutes, no more society.
No, yeah. True. And that's so one of the reasons why. Definitely. No doubt.
The guy who makes the most money on YouTube, he makes between $7 and $12 million per year. He's a guy in Sweden or Denmark, and he goes by the moniker PewDiePie.
No,
and all he does is he gets new video games, sets up his webcam, has fun with
it. Yeah, I think you told me about that. Yeah. But what I'm saying is, it's not the fact that those are the type of videos that people are gonna watch. But it's people that have really just come out of nowhere that, you know, how come this person, you know, why not this? You know what I mean? Like, why did this person end up becoming or getting the ability to have 300,000 views or whatever?
But the thing about it is sometimes you can have the right news or information that is in people's minds that they do searches of and they run across it and then they tell their friends and it goes viral. Or you can do something over the course of time and somebody of notoriety finds it, starts following, and then everybody follows them.
Yeah.
You get the right one person to follow you, subscribe, you're set for life.
Well, part of it is how you set it up as well. Like, most of those people have transcripts, and that helps you. So it has the whole show transcribed. And I can't do that because I have a 2-hour fucking show minimum, and I'm not going to go back and write out my whole fucking show. And mine's different, too, because YouTube is just – the only reason I even have it on YouTube is because Spreaker automatically posts to YouTube. Otherwise, it wouldn't even be on there.
Right.
You know, because I get most of my views. Although I did have a video that got me most of the views were on YouTube, the most I've ever had, in total, like 878 or something, and 850 were on YouTube. But it's just
there's one video. There's another thing that you can do. I believe it's free. It's called Google Hangouts. And anybody, say you got guests on there or whatever, anybody can go ahead and you set up a live stream from there. People, you give them the link, almost like a go to webinar. You give them the link, they go in there, they just click and go in, and you can just have just like the conversation we're having right now.
Yeah, yeah.
And then it gets, when it's done, it's live streaming on YouTube, so anybody can you know, listen in. And then when it's done, it processes it, and boop, your podcast is automatically up on YouTube.
Well, that's what you know, it's doing now. It's automatically, right. I don't have to do anything. It right. automatically posts it and posts all the information.
Well, what
and
I'm
everything.
Saying is to do the Spreaker and what we're doing, you have to have either somebody on Skype or you have to have somebody call in. Through Google Hangouts, all they have to do is plug in their headset or whatever, or use their speaker.
Oh, right, right. Yeah, they can all get together.
You don't have to use Spreaker.
But I have whatever. But I have kind of a more sophisticated setup with, well, I guess it wouldn't matter, but, you know, it's like even where I have Skype going back through the mixer and then going into, you know, the computer. So even the Skype I have going through a mixer, which improves the, you know, I have equalizers and stuff like that where I can, you know, help make the sound even better. So I'm fine with the setup now. The only thing I might do in the future is actually do YouTube video and do it live. So instead of having Spreaker post it, I'll run it through Spreaker live and I'll run it through YouTube live on the same computer and actually have video at some point, but that might not be for a while.
Yeah, see, that's something else is people on YouTube are going to listen to the podcast, but if you're doing something that you're live streaming through YouTube at the same time you're doing Spreaker, more people are going to have, you know, more people are going to go to YouTube than the Spreaker.
Yeah.
So you can get both.
Well, it's also on my website, but both. Yeah. But yeah, okay. So I may at some point do that live. And, you know, we'll see. The other thing I want to do is start doing YouTube videos as well, like 5 to 10 minute YouTube videos of the, you know, to kind of summarize the topic I'm doing. So if I'm doing a show on a certain topic, maybe I'll do a 5 to 10 minute YouTube video. And then at the same time, I'm also writing articles. So I've talked about this before that I want to have all three forms of media, maybe not for every single show. But just, you know, for people that want to actually read, I have articles. For people that want to listen to a radio show, I have the radio show. And then for people that just want the summary of the 5 to 10 minutes, you know, I want to do YouTube videos for that and post them on the channel as well. So,
yeah, the great thing I found was OBS software. I don't know if you've heard of that.
No.
It's called Open Broadcast Software. It's for free download. But it allows you to link directly to your YouTube channel when you do live streaming. And you can do it so you can have a webcam set up. You can do screen capture. If you notice when, you know, my YouTube videos, I started doing...
Where you're showing your screen.
Yeah, showing my screen and showing all the sources of the things that I'm talking about.
Yeah, which is cool.
Yeah, I used to do just have a logo up, and I used to just speak, and then I was paying attention to what people were saying in the comments, and they said, I wish you could, like, can you link all the sources?
So yeah, you're getting a lot of positive comments. I have read your comments, and people, you know, unless you're deleting the negative ones.
No, but I think in 22 podcasts, I've got 3 or 4 dislikes. That's it, out of 22.
Yeah, you get, but even in the, not just the likes where you click the thumbs up, but in the actual comments, I mean, people are very complimentary of the show, which I, you know, when I had told you before, I'm like, you're good on the radio anyway. So, you know, that's why I had suggested it before. I'm like, you should do, you know, some
The problem is I'm an introvert. I'm a natural introvert. So,
yeah, so am I.
I'm self-critical. When I think I hear my voice speaking, that's why I'm a writer.
So,
but you know what? So far, it's been pretty good, so I just keep running with it.
Yeah, I am too. I mean, I can sit behind a mic, and I kind of got used to it because I'm not seeing any of the people that are listening. But it's good to go back and to listen to your own stuff so you can, you know, look at what to improve and stuff like that. So I'll do that, but it took me a while to get to that point. And I've been doing the show now for over 2 years, like 2.5 years. So, but I'm still, I mean, sometimes I'll get nervous or whatever. Not usually, but depending if I have like a certain guest on or something, or I know a certain person is listening or someone's in the chat room that's new, you know, or something like that, because I want to make a good impression on if it's a new listener, I want them to continue to listen. So, yeah, I have that same type thing where I'm just, you know, in general, I'm a shy person, you know, with people I don't know. With people I know, you know, I'm not, but with people I don't know, I'm a shy person.
Yeah, people so. Can't live with them, can't shoot them.
Right. Well, you can actually, but there's ramifications if you do. So speaking of that, I was actually going to play the Larkin Rose when should you shoot a cop, because that actually came up yesterday, and it's a lot different than what it's titled. So hopefully people will stay and listen to that. And then I have a clip about the U.S. airstrike. So we'll probably play those and then be right back to discuss more stories with Ken. So stay tuned. NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com, and check us out at the website. We'll be right back.
When should you shoot a cop? That question, even without an answer, makes most law-abiding taxpayers go into knee-jerk conniptions. The indoctrinated masses all race to see who can be first and loudest to proclaim that it is never okay to forcibly resist law enforcement. In doing so, they also inadvertently demonstrate why so much of human history has been plagued by tyranny and oppression. In an ideal world, cops would do nothing except protect people from thieves and attackers, in which case shooting a cop would never be justified. In the real world, however, far more injustice, violence, torture, theft, and outright murder has been committed in the name of law enforcement than has been committed in spite of it. To get a little perspective, try watching a documentary or two about some of the atrocities committed by the regimes of Stalin or Lenin or Chairman Mao, or Hitler, or Pol Pot, or any number of other tyrants in history. Pause the film when the jackboots are just about to herd innocent people into the cattle cars, or just about to gun them down as they stand on the edge of a ditch, and then ask yourself the question, when should you shoot a cop? Keep in mind, the evils of those regimes were committed in the name of law. And as much as the statement may make people cringe, the history of the human race would have been a lot less gruesome if there had been a lot more cop killers around to deal with the state mercenaries of those regimes. Now, people don't mind when you point out the tyranny that has happened in other countries, but most have a hard time viewing their own country, their own government, and their own law enforcers in any sort of objective way. Having been trained to feel a blind loyalty to the ruling class of the particular piece of dirt they live on, also known as patriotism, and having been trained to believe that obedience is a virtue, the idea of forcibly resisting law enforcement is simply unthinkable to many. Literally, they can't even think about it. And humanity has suffered horribly because of it. It is a testament to the effectiveness of authoritarian indoctrination that literally billions of people throughout history have begged and screamed and cried in the face of authoritarian injustice and oppression, but only a tiny fraction have ever actually lifted a finger to try to stop it. Even when people can recognize tyranny and oppression, they still usually talk about working within the system, the same system that's responsible for the tyranny and the oppression. People want to believe that the system will, sooner or later, provide justice. The last thing they want to consider is that they should illegally resist, that if they want to achieve justice, they must become criminals and terrorists, which is what anyone who resists legal injustice is automatically labeled. But history shows all too well that those who fight for freedom and justice almost always do so illegally, i.e., without the permission of the ruling class. If politicians think that they have the right to impose any law they want, and cops have the attitude that as long as it's called law, they will enforce it, what is there to prevent complete tyranny? Not the consciences of the lawmakers or their hired thugs, obviously, and not any election or petition to the politicians. When tyrants define what counts as law, then by definition, it is up to the lawbreakers to combat tyranny. Pick any example of abuse of power, whether it's the fascist so-called war on drugs, the police thuggery that has become so common, the random stops and searches now routinely carried out in the name of security, such as at airports, border checkpoints that aren't even at the border, sobriety checkpoints, and so on, or any other example. Now ask yourself the uncomfortable question. If it's wrong for cops to do these things, doesn't that imply that the people have a right to resist such actions? And of course, state mercenaries don't take kindly to being resisted, even non-violently. If you question their right to detain you, interrogate you, search you, invade your home, and so on, you are very likely to be tasered, physically assaulted, kidnapped, put in a cage, or shot. If a cop decides to treat you like livestock, whether he does it legally or not, you will usually have only two options: submit or kill the cop. You can't resist a cop just a little and get away with it. He will always call in more of his fellow gang members until you are subdued or dead. Basic logic dictates that you either have an obligation to let law enforcers have their way with you, or you have the right to stop them from doing so, which will almost always require killing them. Politely asking fascists to not be fascists has a very poor track record throughout history. Consider the recent Indiana Supreme Court ruling, which declared that if a cop tries to illegally enter your home, it's against the law for you to do anything to stop him. Aside from the patent absurdity of it, since it amounts to giving thugs with badges permission to break the law and makes it a crime for you to defend yourself against a criminal if he has a badge, consider the logical ramifications of that attitude. There were once some words written on a piece of parchment, those words now known as the Fourth Amendment, that said that you have the right to be free from unreasonable searches and seizures at the hands of government agents. In Indiana today, what could that possibly mean? The message from the ruling class is quite clear and utterly insane. It amounts to this: we don't have the right to invade your home without probable cause, but if we do, you have no right to stop us, and we have the right to arrest you if you try. Why not apply that to the rest of the Bill of Rights while we're at it? You have the right to say what you want, but if we use violence to shut you up, you have to let us. I can personally attest to the fact that that is the attitude of the U.S. so-called Department of Justice. Or maybe, you have the right to have guns, but if we try to forcibly and illegally disarm you and you resist, we have the right to kill you. Ask Randy Weaver or the Branch Davidians about that one. You have the right to not testify against yourself, but when we coerce you into confessing and call it a plea agreement, you can't do a thing about it. What good is a right? What does the term right even mean if you have an obligation to allow jackboots to violate your so-called rights? It makes the term absolutely meaningless. To be blunt, if you have the right to do A, it means that if someone tries to stop you from doing A, even if he has a badge and a politician's scribble, sometimes called law, on his side, you have the right to use whatever amount of force is necessary to resist that person. That's what it means to have an unalienable right. If you have the unalienable right to speak your mind, a la the First Amendment, then if all else fails, you have the right to kill government agents who try to shut you up. If you have the unalienable right to be armed, then if all else fails, you have the right to kill government agents who try to disarm you. If you have the right to not be subjected to unreasonable searches and seizures, then if all else fails, you have the right to kill government agents who try to inflict those upon you. Those who are proud to be law-abiding don't like to hear this and don't like to think about this, but what's the alternative? If you do not have the right to forcibly resist so-called legal injustice, that logically implies that you have an obligation to allow government agents to do absolutely anything they want to you, your home, your family, your neighbors, and so on. Really, there are only two choices. You are a slave, the property of the politicians, without any rights at all, or you have the right to violently resist government attempts to oppress you. There can be no other option. Of course, on a practical level, openly resisting the gang called government is usually very hazardous to one's health. But there's a big difference between obeying for the sake of self-preservation, which is often necessary and rational, and feeling a moral obligation to go along with whatever the ruling class wants to do to you, which is pathetic and insane. Most of the incomprehensible atrocities that have occurred throughout history were due in large part to the fact that most people answer never to the question of when should you shoot a cop. The correct answer is, when evil is legal, become a criminal. When oppression is enacted as law, become a lawbreaker. And when those violently victimizing the innocent have badges, become a cop killer.
62 people have been killed by U.S. airstrikes on the Syrian army, according to the Russian Ministry of Defense. RT's Paula Slier has more details.
The Russian Defense Ministry has confirmed that U.S.-led coalition planes attacked Syrian forces after entering Syrian airspace from the Iraqi border. We're hearing that there were four strikes, 62 Syrian soldiers were killed and 100 were injured. This position of the Syrian military was surrounded by Islamic State. So after the strikes, Islamic State militants were able to advance forward. Now, the Russian Defense Ministry is saying that even if this attack was carried out because of false coordinates, what it does show is the consequences of the United States' unwillingness to cooperate with Russia on locating targets and coordinating anti-terror efforts.
We believe that this incident took place due to the U.S.'s lack of intelligence in the surrounding area, but also because of the unwillingness of it to coordinate its counter-terrorist actions in Syria with Russia.
Now, there has also been a statement that has been issued by the U.S. Central Command. It says that it believed that this position that it struck was an Islamic State position that it had been tracking for quite some time, and that as soon as it was informed by the Russians and the Syrians that it was possible that it had hit Syrian personnel and Syrian military vehicles, it immediately suspended its operation.
Syria is a complex situation with various military forces and militias in close proximity, but coalition forces would not intentionally strike a known Syrian military unit. The coalition will review this strike and the circumstances surrounding it to see if any lessons can be learned.
At the same time, the Syrian army says that this is, to quote, a serious and blatant aggression against the army and shows conclusively that the United States and its allies support Islamic State and other terrorist organizations.
The U.S. Army was previously accused of hitting Syrian troops in the same province back in December 2015.
The strategy that we are using now, airstrikes, special forces, and working with local forces who are fighting to regain control of their own country. That is how we'll achieve a more sustainable victory.
Mind. closed doors. UN Security Council meeting behind closed doors. However, the U.S. ambassador to the UN, Samantha Power, branded Russia's call, quote, cynical and hypocritical. RT News editor Igor Zhdanov has the details.
Of course, everybody was anticipating Samantha Power, the U.S. ambassador to the UN, SC, and her Russian counterpart, Vitaly Churkin, to take podiums. And Samantha Power was the first one to, I would say, vent her anger publicly, to vent her outrage in front of the media. And when I say outrage, I'm not exaggerating, because she was furious about having to convene, about being summoned on Russia's call to discuss the airstrike. And this is something that she didn't really address in her speech properly. She kind of sidelined the whole airstrike thing. Let's actually have a listen as to what she had to say.
Russia decided to join the Assad regime, escalating the conflict, and perhaps worst of all, itself adopting some of the regime's worst practices, hitting hospitals, hitting refugee camps. And they're calling this emergency meeting? Really? Now, because of a single airstrike, a strike that if it struck regime forces, did so in error, a strike that we have swiftly acknowledged and committed to investigating.
Vitaly Churkin took podium right after his American counterpart, and as he revealed that Samantha Power did not hold back on her hard feelings behind closed doors as well. In fact, by her approach, she managed to surprise even Vitaly Churkin. Let's have a listen to how he describes what happened behind closed doors.
As I was talking in the Security Council, sharing our analysis and frustration over the situation of Syria, Ambassador Power chose to talk to you. The only thing her deputy had to say in response to my comments was that the U.S. is investigating what has happened at Deir Azor. As Ambassador Power walked in, first thing she said, she was not interested in what I had to say, because what I was saying is a stunt.
Well, so the Russians called this UN Security Council, this emergency UN Security Council, specifically to talk some things over. And this is what the UNSC is for some of the world's strongest powers to resolve the issues that emerged between them diplomatically. And this is exactly that didn't happen, the diplomatic conversation between Vitaly Churkin and Samantha Power. And it seems that they had a lot to discuss there because, well, first of all, according to Vitaly Churkin, the United States, if they carried out that airstrike, they violated two commitments that the United States had agreed on last week. That is, of course, not to attack the Syrian army, not to strike the Syrian army, and to commit to the ceasefire. Secondly, he pointed out the suspicious timing of the attack because, one, the Syrian army is stationed in Deir Ezzor. The Deir Ezzor is the region that's been hit by this airstrike. So it is kind of unusual of the United States military to assist the Syrian army because they're supporting, they're coordinating with the opposition. Mm-hmm. He even went as far as floating the idea that the American airstrike could be a provocation because, of course, the only side, and well, not the only, but one of the sides that is very happy with the airstrikes are Islamic State terrorists who are right now besieging the area. And also Vitaly Churkin highlights that the United States are not in control of the situation in Syria. And there have been a few troubling examples and that are proving this point. For example, one, the United States have been supporting the opposition. They've been training the opposition. And their trained rebels would eventually defect to the jihadists, taking American-supplied arms with them. And two, they've been working for months now on separating the so-called moderate opposition from the jihadis, like the al-Nusra Front, of course. Mm-hmm. And so far, they've been failing at this. So really a shame that the meeting didn't happen between Vitaly Churkin and Samantha Power. There's a lot to discuss, well, hopefully on some other diplomatic levels. This won't really be an end to that, you know, very fragile cooperation established between the United States and Russia through the personal relationship of Sergei Lavrov, the Russian top diplomat, and, of course, John Kerry.
Are you looking for a podcast that talks about life, the universe, and everything? Listen in to the Illumination Hour, Monday nights, 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Pacific. Listen live at Spreaker.com or NonPartisanLibertyForAll.com. We're also on SoundCloud, Spreaker, Twitter, Tumblr, YouTube, and iTunes. The Illumination Hour, brought to you by Nonpartisan Liberty for All Media and Radio Network. And your host, Ellen Stallone. Because a spark can illuminate the world. You are listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with your host, Dave Bourne. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
I can't believe the fucking arrogance of the U.S. government. I mean, I know they are arrogant, but just fucking, I don't know. Oops, we bombed the Syrian military when we said we wouldn't, and we just killed a bunch of people. Oh, sorry. It was, you know, it was a mistake. We're here with Ken Schortgen of The Daily Economist and his own YouTube show on the Ken Schortgen channel on YouTube. Ken, I don't know if you were you able to or did you listen to any of that report on what happened in Syria?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. You know, I was pretty much.
I know we talked about it earlier, but.
Yeah. No, I, you know, there's a lot of scuttlebutt coming out from it. I hate to say it. I tend to believe Russian media much more than I do Western media.
Yeah. Unfortunately, that is the case. I agree with you.
There's an interesting podcast, if anybody wants to listen to it. The Wednesday interview with Greg Hunter, go over to USA Watchdog, and he had Paul Craig Roberts. Now, for those who may have heard the name or don't know him.
He's been on Alex Jones a bunch of times.
Yeah, Paul Craig Roberts was the Assistant Secretary of the Treasury under Reagan, and he is considered the individual, the main individual who ended the Soviet Union, because he wrote a book in the 1970s on how the Russian five-year plan was going to fail and destroy their economy. And it ended up coming absolutely true. And when the Soviet Union fell in 89-90, he was invited to go over to the Russian Ministry of Economics, and they gave him an award because he was so dead on with understanding their economy.
Yeah, I didn't know that about him. I did know that he was in the Reagan administration and that he's on Alex Jones from time to time and kind of speaks out against the government on a lot of things.
Yeah, in his interview on USA Watchdog today, he spoke about the fact that the U.S. government is controlled by what we would call the neocons, neoconservatives. And they follow a belief when the Soviet Union fell called the Wolfowitz Doctrine. And the Wolfowitz Doctrine says this, is that the United States will ensure that no country rises to the power that they can have their own self-sustaining foreign policy. All foreign policy from the fall of the Soviet Union, where there's just one superpower, all foreign policy around the world must come from the United States.
Yeah, because they're fucking empire is mm-hmm. is what they are. And that's, you know, they're not as blatant about it. I mean, they don't try to, you know, announce it. But, I mean, it's pretty obvious. And even from their own documents, I mean, it's obvious in all of the things that they've done throughout the years, that they've created an empire. It's just not your typical you know, empire like Hitler was trying to do and just invade all these other countries and take them over. They do a lot of the, you know, covert shit and behind the scenes stuff. Or they use other reasons like they're doing now with Syria, where, you know, I don't even know what their rationale is now. Just that Assad's a bad dictator and people are unhappy. It's a bunch of bullshit. They should have nothing to do with it.
See, but here's something you got to understand, okay, is that every single nation, culture, and the like is different. There's an old saying in Russia, okay, Russians demand a strong man, even if he's brutal, you know, not cruel and, you know, over authoritarian, but they want a strong man. They do not work, the Russian people as a culture do not work well. That's electing their own officials or having somebody who's weak.
Putin walks around with his shirt off. I know you had a story that that China's using him as like a not a spokesmodel, but like as a advertiser or to promote products.
Yeah.
His image, that they're, you know, he's doing commercials for them.
Because of the popularity of Putin as a strong man, and he's, you know, strong men are respected in Asia. See, that's what I'm saying about cultures. In the Far East, you know, Japan has equalized it a little bit, but still in the Far East, women are subservient. Men are expected to be the strong, you know, the strong. But Putin is seen as a strong man, especially since the fact that he stands up to the U.S. And so his image has become a branding symbol for products made in China.
Isn't there ice cream?
Yeah, there's
Ben and Putin's.
Well, it's a Russian. Russia has a special ice cream that the Chinese just absolutely love. And so it was kind of funny because at the G20, Putin brought some of that ice cream with him off the plane and gave it to Xi Jinping, the leader of China. And they had a big, patting each other on the back and had a gay old time because Xi Jinping loves that ice cream.
Well, I don't know if you should use that terminology in this day and age.
Yeah,
but they had a gay old time.
I can't use the English language. I'm sorry.
Well, anyway, I say they had a gay old time. People might get the wrong idea.
No, go back to the 70s and the Flintstones. You know?
I know. That was in the song, in the Flintstones theme song. We'll have a gay old time, yeah. Wilma.
you know, the term gay actually came, we'll diverge here a second.
It meant happy.
It meant a little bit more than that. The word comes from the French word goy that came out of about the 13th century that meant happy and carefree. Now, the carefree is the important part. As language changed and words changed, about the 16th, 17th century, the word goy turned to gay, and it was attributed to those who were carefree in their sexual persuasion. I.e., prostitutes were called gay, and the Johns that went to, hired them for services were called gay because they were carefree in their sexual lifestyles. And then in the 1920s, the carefree sexual lifestyle went to its furthest thing when the homosexual community co-opted the word.
Yeah, but they were still using it even in, like you said, like in the Flintstones, and I mean, that was like, what, the 60s, the 70s?
Yeah.
That the Flintstones were around?
There's an era in America called the gay 90s, and it refers to the 1890s in the Wild West.
Oh, I was going to say, the gay 90s.
The gay 90s in the Wild West, 1890s, represented carefree. There was no law, do what you want, you know, and just the whole nine yards, so...
Yeah, I probably would have liked that time, except I don't know about the horse riding and the...
And the fact that if you piss somebody off, they're just going
to
shoot you.
That's okay. I'm not, you know, scared to die. I wouldn't have liked the, I like to take showers every day and shit like that. So I would have had some problems. I like soap. I don't even know that they had soap.
Oh, yeah. It was made from ash and lye.
Well,
it was harsh as sin on your skin.
Now it's like animal fat and shit. I mean, we made soap, and it still has some fucking, if you make it the wrong way, it can, like,
lye is burn toxic.
Yeah, that's what I mean. If you make it, because I think it's still made with lye kind of chemicals. Because we made soap in chemistry, and I took chemistry in college, and we made soap, and I fucked it all up. But it, if you make it the wrong way, it's like, it's kind of dangerous, like toxic.
Oh,
but
no doubt.
But sorry, so back to
Putin in China.
And they're
selling T-shirts with Putin's face and you know, upper body on it, mugs. There's a meme going around with Putin wearing mirrored sunglasses, and the meme goes, "Don't worry, America, I got this." And they took that picture from that meme, and they started putting them on coffee mugs.
See, I don't know. When it comes to any leader of any government, as far as, you know, whatever, if they're using them to sell products, that's one thing. But,
take the government out of it. He's a symbol.
Yeah, no, I understand.
People still wear those T-shirts with Che Guevara. The dude was a cruel killer. He was an assassin for Fidel Castro.
I don't know a lot about him. Wasn't he communist?
Well, yeah. He was part of Fidel Castro's death squads when they took over Cuba. And then after Cuba was solidified, Che Guevara, a revolutionary, went to look for his next revolution. And he went down, I think, to Bolivia and a few others. And there is, you know, there are tens of thousands of people.
Yeah, there's a lot of people that wear those shirts.
And in his order, so.
There's a lot of people that wear the shirts that probably don't know anything about them. It's funny, when I woke up this morning, the Michael Moore documentary Sicko was on, and the scene where they go to Cuba, and, you know, saying how great it is because, you know, they get free health care and the doctors are so nice and all this shit. Like, yeah, well, how many people did Castro kill?
Michael Moore, a lot of those people that are going into the hospitals, they can't even afford shirts or shoes. They can get free health care, but they can't afford to buy clothes.
Right.
You know, you're an idiot. And take a look. They got
misrepresentation.
They had to learn to take care of their cars because, you know, they couldn't afford to import anything after 1950.
Yeah, it was a total misrepresention of what it, you know, what it really is.
I call liberals, liberalism is the rich white man's guilt. You know, the Barbara Streisands who beg everybody to donate money towards their cause, but they're not going to give any money themselves.
Well, I mean, we had talked about, not we, because you, but yesterday on the show, you know, how essentially you're not owed anything. Okay. Maybe, you know, your parents have an obligation, but really they could just give you up for adoption if they wanted to. Besides that, no one owes you anything. You don't have, there's a new thing with progressives, and we talked about this yesterday, about, you know, positive rights. Like, they believe, well, I have the right to live and not be shot, so that means guns should be banned. Like, that type of mentality, as opposed to negative rights, which I believe are human rights that you are born with, like the right to put what you want in your body, or the right to self-defense, or whatever. Rights that don't involve the resources of other people, like healthcare, you're essentially saying that you have the right for somebody else to provide a service to you and to their labor, and you don't.
Oh, yeah.
And that's the whole thing, that they're twisting freedoms into positive freedoms, which is not freedom. You know, it's suppression of other people's freedoms. So
yeah, but there's an interesting thing. You know, the Constitution doesn't promise anything or anybody anything except an opportunity. Okay, the law is supposed to protect you to the point where you have an
opportunity. Not all people, you're not gonna be originally.
You're not going to be discriminated against. Well, yeah, but you know that's a different cup of tea. You know, if you really want to look at the reasoning behind why blacks were kept as slaves and the Indians weren't put
women,
in,
women too. I mean, they couldn't vote.
But see, you know, even in Europe, women were still second class citizens then. And
in England, I mean, that doesn't make it okay.
No, but things change over time. That was the philosophy for thousands of years in most cultures. Things don't happen overnight. Okay. That's the thing. What, you know, we live in a society today where blacks are equal, Indians are equal, women are equal. But you know what? The thing about it is it took a lot of work and generations to change that. We're living in a time when the generations already fought the fight, and we're just reaping the benefits of it, of equality. But for thousands of years, it wasn't like that in most cultures.
Well, I still wouldn't say people are equal, especially if you look at politics and you have if all these other people have extra rights like police and politicians and government officials.
Yeah, but that has to do with the government takeover that doesn't have anything to do with individuals treating other individuals. You know, if you own a business, you have the choice whether to pay a man and a woman the same thing. You know, you can do that.
Well,
the government doesn't stand above you and force you.
They do force you to do certain things.
It doesn't force you to pay a woman less.
No, but they
that's a choice.
Who knows for how much longer you have that choice. But there's a lot of things that you don't have a choice in. As far as, you know, businesses are very regulated in hiring. And, you know, I believe that a business should be able to do whatever the fuck they want. And I don't mean, like, you know, go out and do bad things. But if it's your business.
Shop, if you're a bake shop and you don't want to make a cake for a gay wedding, you shouldn't have to.
Well, I'll take it a step further that you shouldn't have to hire people you don't want to hire. You shouldn't have to do anything. It's right. Your business, and you shouldn't have to comply with, you know, all these ridiculous regulations.
You're seeing things in the ideological mindset instead of
reality. It's not in the...
My point is this, okay? Just like the fact that Thomas Jefferson said that the Republic will stand until the people discover that they can vote themselves the largesse of the treasury, and then it turns into a democracy. Once the people realize they can vote in elected leaders who are going to give them a bunch of crap, then it's over. Well, it's the same thing with business. Only 3% of a population are entrepreneurs. Okay, only 3%. That means 97% are workers who look out for their own interests, not the interest of the business. You're looking out for the interest of the business, of your workers, of the regulations, of your profit line. If you're a corporation, then you have to deal with shareholders and board. See, the business owner has to take on all the risks. The worker just shows up for work.
Right, but the government has made it a lot harder to get into a lot of businesses because of these regulations.
You're absolutely right.
The barriers to entry.
Where do these laws come from? 99% of these horrific regulatory laws.
Corporations, a lot of them.
No, they come from somebody, a small little squeaky wheel, making a big scene, and then it's saying.
Some of those type of laws, like.
I
agree with you on that, and we've talked about that before, but I'm talking about the ones that benefit these big corporations and they lobby government for, that makes the barriers to entry into a certain industry harder.
Oh, true.
So I'm talking more about those. I know what you're talking about, and that's true as well.
The problem with these corporations that you're talking about is we have the laws in the book. It's called the Sherman Antitrust Act.
Yeah, but
the problem is that they're not enforcing it.
Right. It doesn't matter. Government does whatever the fuck they want. But so there were some other stories. We only got about 10 minutes left, but I know you had some other stories that you went over, so I'll let you in, finish up with whatever you want to go
today
through.
We had the last 24 hours, we had two huge central bank meetings. The Bank of Japan, they decided not to raise rates. Well, you know, how much are even lower rates?
Didn't they stay at they're at a negative interest rate?
Yeah, they're at negative 0.10, 0.1% negative. So, that means that is if you borrow money, they'll give you extra, and if you put your money in a bank account, then you get it taken away.
They'll tax you on it, basically. Like they'll charge you a fee.
That's pretty much it. Now, the important one was the FOMC meeting, the Federal Reserve. The Federal Reserve decided that they weren't going to change rates. And then when Janet Yellen, a half hour after that announcement came out, Janet Yellen came and jawboned, took some questions, and pretty much said, the economy's good, but we're still data dependent.
The economy's good based on what? The stock market. That's it. And that's because they prop up the stock market. Where's the economy good?
See, the economy to the central bank are assets. That's the economy. Not your jobs.
Right.
Not your wages. Not your standard of living. No, they could care less about that. It has become the point that they're there to protect the stock market.
Yeah, and they prop it up with their – I mean, how much are they printing now? Because I remember we talked at one point, and it might have been a year ago – where they were doing like $80 billion a month, but then they cut it down. But are they still doing that?
They cut it down on the surface where people can see. Behind the scenes, they're probably printing close to $500 billion a month to buy bonds, to roll over, because all this debt has.
Oh, so they're doing over. Yeah, because weren't. Before they were taking like $80 billion and giving it to banks or something.
Yeah, exactly. Now here's the.
But so they're not
thing.
Doing that anymore, or
they're doing that.
Are they
they're
still doing
that.
The same amount, or
well,
did
the
they cut
is
it down?
That the banks are so in debt that it's not enough. You have Deutsche Bank, the Germany's largest bank that is insolvent.
And they're trying to merge with somebody or something,
they
right?
They have seven. If they sold off right now, they have $17.5 billion in assets. And they have $1.375 trillion in liabilities.
What was the first number?
$17.5 billion.
And 1.375 trillion. Right.
In liabilities.
So weren't they trying to? One of your stories that they were trying to merge with another bank, or
they may be trying to merge with another German bank called Commerzbank.
Why would another bank even want to merge with them and take on those liabilities?
Well, because who knows? The reason is because the central banks are going to protect them both. Because if Deutsche Bank falls, it sets a domino chain reaction, and 2008 looks like a picnic.
Are they that big?
They are the biggest bank in Europe. They're Germany's biggest bank. Yeah, and they have $70 trillion in derivatives.
So that's a lot.
Now, here's a significant thing I want to tell you about the central banks. And this is a scary thought, okay? I wrote an article last week over at Rogue Money that the central banks are turning capitalism into socialism. Now, how are they doing this? Well, the Bank of Japan has bought up every single bond that they could get their hands on for the last 10 years. Well, there's no more bonds.
You're talking about Japan's central bank?
Yeah. So if they're not buying bonds, what are they buying? They're buying stocks. And right. The Bank of Japan owns about 50% of all the stocks on the Nikkei 225 exchange. Okay. Switzerland. Switzerland is not only buying their own stocks, but they are the biggest shareholder in Apple. They're buying U.S. stocks. And the Fed.
What percentage of Apple do they own?
They're the biggest pure shareholder. I think they own like $130 million worth of
I mean, like what
Apple shares.
like what percent? I mean, are they
I'm not sure
the majority. The majority stockholder? Do they vote
well,
in?
Well, see, there's two different types of stock in a company. There's common stock and there's preferred stock.
So they just own common stock?
Yeah, they're largest common stockholder.
Okay.
Now, the point is that as the Fed has probably been buying stocks, if not pumping it up, what happens when the central bank all of a sudden owns, you know, by the way, the Fed is the country's largest landlord. They bought all those mortgage-backed securities that the banks had in 2008. And those are all the
so they own all those houses
for the mortgages.
Yeah,
for those foreclosed houses. They're the Fed has printed money out of thin air and bought up all the assets. Now, what happens if they start buying stocks? Well, if they own the majority share of stocks, guess what? They're the largest shareholder. They can start picking and choosing who's going to be on the board. Then they can start telling the company what they can and can't produce, who they can and can't hire. And they suddenly turned, by printing money out of nothing, a capitalist system into socialism where they control the means of production.
Well, technically they're not part of the government, but they...
No, they're a private entity. It's a fascinating thought,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah, it's
printing money out of thin air to buy every single asset out there.
And while the economy still sucks.
Yep. The other story I want to talk about is, I know you're going to get hyped when I mention who it is, but we'll set that aside. The Dallas Police Pension Fund is a microcosm of why the U.S. financial system doesn't price things mark to market. Now, for those who don't understand, there are two types of pricing when it comes to accounting. There's mark to model and mark to market. Mark to model means that, say you buy a house that's worth $650,000, okay? On your books, on your ledger, you're going to say, I have an asset worth $650,000. But in the real market, say the price goes down 40%. So the house is only really worth, if you sold it, you could only get $485,000. That's the current day price. That's known as mark to market.
You keep the actual, the higher amount on your books, right? And then depreciate that amount.
Asset is only worth $485,000 on your books. You say you have an asset worth $650,000.
Well, that would be an asset that you wouldn't even depreciate because you're not using it for, you know, like when you buy equipment or something like that, you know, correct, you amortize it over 10 years or whatever the, you know.
Correct. But a pension fund's not going to buy construction, you know, equipment for use. They're going to buy assets.
Right, right. I'm saying that it's different than it would just sit. That amount is not going to change. It's going to sit at that amount unless it ever went up.
And you wouldn't consider those things assets. Well, you would in a sense, but they're a different type of assets.
So they're showing assets, well, a lot higher than what they're worth. So it makes them look like they have, they're worth a lot more money than they are.
They've got all these assets in the pension fund. So when they tell regulators, hey, we're well funded in our pension fund.
But they're not.
Right.
Because they're not equal to the assets are not equal to the market value.
Exactly. And here's what happened. There was a raid on the pension fund by the FBI in April of this year. And what they did was they did an audit of the pension fund. And what they did is they forced the pension fund to mark to market their entire real estate book, which means that all the assets they owned of property inside the pension fund were then marked to market instead of marked to model. When they came through with this audit that finished, the value of the pension fund fell by 32%. So the amount of money that they had in the pension fund to pay out beneficiaries was actually 32% less than what they said they could do.
Right, and so they're not fully funded.
So they're not even close to fully funded. Let me tell you something. If you're 7% underfunded in a pension fund, you are considered in the danger zone.
And they said they're 32%.
They're 32.
Well, they're police, so fuck them.
So what ended up happening is the police department is saying, the police officers, whether they're retired or active duty, are saying, screw this, and they're withdrawing all their money from the pension fund because they, you know, they've got the signal that this thing could go, you know.
Well, what happens when everybody tries to withdraw their money and they don't have enough?
Well, it's always first in, first out, or...
Right. You know, so right. People will end up without.
This is why Americans are the worst investors in the world because we buy high and sell low. You buy when nobody, the way to invest is to do your due diligence.
Buy low and sell high. Yeah.
If you had bought mining stocks, which after 2011, mining stocks were crushed. When the gold and silver prices were crushed down, mining stocks fell 95% from their value in 2011.
And that's when you scoop them up. If you bought
most of the good mining stocks in December of last year, you would have made between 1 to 5 times your money. And right now, they're still so – even with making a 500% return – they're still something like 70% below what their high was in 2011.
So are these the type of things that are just happening everywhere? Is it just an example of the type of things that we're going to see, in a whole bunch of other pension funds and things like that?
Yeah, it's kind of interesting because there are two central banks, Denmark and Sweden, that are now buying mining stocks. They each put $100 million into mining stocks. They're not buying Apple. They're not buying Amazon or Netflix because those companies are so overpriced.
Because the demand for gold is going to go up?
Yes. I did the podcast you were doing. Last week, last Tuesday, I think it was September 13th. You guys can find it on there. I was asked by the listeners to do a special gold and silver show. So I went through and I discussed about what gold and silver is used for, monetary metal, industrial metal, and then the different ways that you can, you should set yourself up. I said you want to have some cash out of the bank. Because even if the ATMs and the banks go down, cash will still be king for a while.
You don't want any savings in the bank.
Right. The second thing, gold is for wealth protection. Okay? This is where you want to store your wealth. Silver is for investment. Now, there's a big difference between investment and speculation. Investment is what you would pretty much call a sure thing. Okay? If you buy a farm... you're pretty much assured you're going to grow something and make some money off of selling that, whatever. It may not be a whole lot of profit, but you're pretty much going to come out ahead. It's as close to a sure thing as you can do. Investment.
Well, long term is exactly. Really what silver and really is, and then gold.
Well, silver, but you got to look at the fundamentals of silver. What is the world rushing towards? The world is rushing away from oil and into alternative energy.
But yeah, silver is used for a lot of things, industrial. Isn't it
for every
fiber optic cable or something? Or
no, that's a different type.
There's something, though, that they're using silver for. Okay.
For every kilowatt hour of solar panel, it takes 1/3 of an ounce of silver.
Well, there
and
you
if
go.
The world, if China is,
that's
is
why they're so fucking expensive,
right? China's already preparing to pretty much get off of oil when they can, and they're going to go nearly completely solar the entire thing. So they're going to be scrambling. As a matter of fact, there is such a shortage for silver that one of the miners, his name is Keith Neumeyer, and if you in my opinion, do your due diligence on it. But if you can find any company that has Keith Neumeyer's name to it, you jump on it. Absolutely jump on it. Keith Neumeyer has one of the biggest pure silver mines in the world. And Apple, which uses silver in all of their iPhones and all their electronics, Apple is no longer going to the COMEX looking for silver. They're going straight to the miners. Keith Neumeyer said that in an interview recently that Apple went to him asking for his complete supply for the next 6 months.
To buy it directly from him? So then those stocks will be going up.
Because the supply is absolutely dead.
Yeah. And it's went up like $4. I remember when it was $16. Now it's like over $20. And I think when I bought silver that I no longer have, I bought it at like 16 or 17. But yeah,
silver and gold had a nice 2 days thanks to the Bank of Japan and the Fed today. Yeah.
But that's about all the time we have left. So anything you want to mention before we go?
No, just go ahead and check out thedailyeconomist.com and go to YouTube and look up my name or just put in The Daily Economist and it should pull up my podcasts. And, if you comment in there and something you want me to discuss, I'll be more than glad to do that.
Yeah, and as I mentioned, you've gotten a lot of positive comments from people. They really like the show, which like I had said before, I had always thought, because you were good on here and what any other show that you appeared on, so you do a good job. I think you need to get a new mic, but besides that, I think everything's pretty good. But not that the mic's bad, it's good enough. But,
No, I just got an old Logitech headset.
Yeah. Well, I can recommend you a good mic that's pretty cheap if you want a USB mic, if that's what you want
to
do. But
yeah, I need to get some more USB ports. I got to get a USB hub.
I'll if you want, there's this mic. It's usually, I have a couple of them. It's between $50 and $70, depending on, because I bought it before for $50. I bought it before for $70. I don't know where it's at now. So, and it's a pretty solid mic. And then you get yourself some closed headphones for like $20, and you're good. And the sound quality will probably improve on that. So, but thanks again, as always, for joining us. As you know, one of the things that we all need to pay attention to is what's going on, definitely in the economy, because that really affects you, but in the world as well. All the corrupt shit that the fucking U.S. government is doing, really. But so we'll be back tomorrow. I'm playing the wrong thing. There we go. We'll be back tomorrow. With I haven't scheduled a show yet, but I believe we're going to talk about the cashless society model and where that seems to be going and all of the things that would cause, like the ability to track every transaction and stop you from making transactions and all of that shit. So it would be another attack on freedom, a huge one. But thanks, everybody, for listening. And thanks again to Ken. Go check out his YouTube channel and The Daily Economist. And I'll see you tomorrow. Thanks, everybody. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous